what would be your job? First of all, let's turn to 2 Timothy 2 and verse 12. 2 Timothy 2 and verse 12.
Amen.
This is first how you get your job. This is rather laying it out briefly. So we read in 2 Timothy 2 and verse 12, it says, if we endure hardship, we will reign with him. If we deny him, he will deny us. Okay. So that's just putting it simply. If you follow and obey Christ, then you will reign with him. If you do not follow and obey Christ, he's going to deny you. And we kind of get it more focused when we go to 1 Peter 2, verse 8 and 9. 1 Peter 2 and verse 8 and 9. Just let me do this. You don't have to really, you can turn there, but just in case you don't. And it talks about Christ being the chief cornerstone. Again, it's talking about accepting him as the chief cornerstone. That means the foundation of this thing we call Christianity, the foundation of eternal life. And they said he is the chief cornerstone, but some have rejected that cornerstone.
Preach.
And so if you have not rejected that cornerstone, then he has called you. He has called you. And what he has called you to, as he says in verse 9, he said, but you are a chosen generation,
yes,
a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous
yes
light.
Amen.
And that's the way it is, because you don't come to Jesus, so to speak. God has to draw you to Jesus. The scriptures teach that. Some people go around and say, well, I saved so-and-so, and I saved, you have not saved anyone if you think that way. You cannot even save yourself. And so we read in the Gospel of John 6:44, Jesus himself says, no one can come to me unless the Father draws him.
Yeah.
And then I will raise him up and give him his brand new job on the last day. So you cannot even come to Jesus unless the Father okays it. He has to open your mind to some respect so you can even understand who Jesus is.
Yeah.
Because in other words, he'd be just like a some foreigner that you have never met before, speaking a language you do not understand. So in Old Testament times, it was the priest's job to teach the people God's ways and laws. That was their job. But in the coming kingdom, when Jesus returns, it's going to be our job. As it was read in Revelation 1 and verse 6, we are going to be kings and priests with the Lord. Revelation 20, verse 1 through 5, you can read that at another time, but to paraphrase what it says, there's going, when he returns, he's going to have a 1,000-year reign. And the Bible says at this particular time that Satan is going to be bound up, he and all of his demons, and they're going to be thrown into a bottomless pit. When most people think of that, they think of, where could that bottomless pit be on this earth? There is no such thing as a bottomless pit on this earth or anywhere else there is a physical planet or asteroid or any other such thing, because they have limits. A bottomless pit does not have limits.
Right.
So in other words, he's telling you he's going to be in a place in a dimension that you don't know. Totally out of the way. This is something that's coming out of a heavenly, you can say a heavenly holding place. So he will have no effect whatsoever upon folks anymore when that occurs, when Jesus returns, and you will see the difference. Mm-hmm. You see the difference in attitude. People be like this. You know, all that bad, evil stuff that just pops up in their mind, we won't be there.
Right.
Won't be there. So we will be with him reigning for 1,000 years until that 1,000 years are up. During that time, our job will be to teach the people that are left on this earth after the tribulation. Now this is going to let you know just how blessed you are to be chosen a king or a priest in the kingdom which is to come, and it is coming soon. I do believe those that are younger than us will live to see it. There's been other revelations that has gone on that Europe right now is seeking a man that is going to bring them out of their economic situation, out of their political situations, and bring it all together. And they say they don't care what this man is or who he is or what he believes. It's as long as he's smart enough to get this, and we will follow him. Hallelujah. And if you are keen on the prophecy, this man has to appear that's going to do just that. And they're already searching for him. So anyway, after the tribulation and the wrath of God, there's two sections in here that's going to last you 7 years. 3.5 years of the tribulation, and Jesus is going to come back for 3.5 years to finish his ministry. But this time in power and great glory.
Yes,
so between Satan murdering people and God's wrath, over 58% of the population will perish during this particular time. That's a lot of folks.
Yes, mm-hmm.
It may be, right now we're over 7 billion people, so maybe it might be, by the time that occurs, it might be 8 billion. So you can say 5 billion is going to bite the dust.
Yes.
That's a lot of people. How do you bury 5 billion people? What diseases come from bodies left out in the open when they start to decay? And all of the bacteria and diseases, like I said, all this stuff is going to go down. Because those who are dead is going to kill those who are living. Mm-hmm. So you're going to have a great mess. So it is a beautiful thing if you've been called. Mm-hmm. And I suggest if you're not called, ask it. But after all that destruction that's going to be on the face of the earth, there shall be a peace that's going to come that has not been since the beginning. A peace you have no understanding or has never felt. If you felt that peace, you was probably a little bitty baby, you don't even remember. Because Satan is gone. He is gone, him and his demons. And you know what they call him? They call him the prince of the power of the air.
Right.
Prince of the power of the air. Why do they call him that? Ephesians 2 and verse 2. Ephesians 2 and verse 2. And it reads, they say, in which you once walked according to the course of this world and all of its doings and shenanigans, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now works in the sons of disobedience. So if you are a son of disobedience, you are a son or a daughter of this world, doing what the world says and rolling with the world and all of its sins, then you are a son and a daughter of disobedience. So you are actually a son or daughter of Satan. And he is the prince of the power of the air. Even at this time, God is telling you one thing, and they hadn't invented radios and TVs at this particular time when this was made up. But he's letting you know that this individual has a power to surcharge the air with an evil attitude that can penetrate all of us, even those of us that has God's Holy Spirit. And when it comes, what that Holy Spirit allows you to know that this is evil. That's why you got to read the word so you can be able to discern the difference. Because he's clever and he will fix your mind on those things of your weaknesses in the first place, and he'll cover it up with a little bit of truth, and all behind it is a false floor. And then before you know it, you're in full-blown sin and think you are doing right.
Amen.
Because this goes right along with what I was thinking anyway. Tricked. That's why he's the prince of the power of the air, just like on the radio, what you hear on the radio, these airwaves. You can't see a radio airwave or that signal that comes into your TV and make it turn on when you see images from around the world. You can't see Satan's either, but it's there. Ever prevalent. Whenever you got a mean, evil, revengeful thought, you have just listened to his broadcast. So during the time when Christ returns, there will be, as I said, a time of peace and plenty like the world has never seen before. And during that particular time, everything that will be done, everything that will be built, will be done right. There will be no shortcuts, nobody taking something or building a building that's going to give you cheap cement or pig iron for steel in order to get his advantage and increase his profits. None of that will occur. Everything will be done for the good of humanity the way it was intended in the first place. And no longer will there be a thought, an evil thought, blasting the minds of anyone that is left alive during that particular time.
Amen.
And let me tell you something. When they come out of that, they're going to know the difference.
Yes.
Because if you can kill 4 or 5 billion people and they perish within a 7-year period, there's going to be a lot of stuff going around in the air. Not only disease, but a lot of attitudes and opinions that is going to be ungodly. Because remember, he said, I'm going to move the Holy Spirit out of the way and let this place become a habitation of demons. So now there's no protection. It is Satan wide open. And you could, and if he's doing what he's doing now with all the violence and the upheaval and the hatred and the divisions amongst people, you ain't seen nothing yet.
Right.
But like God has said, Jesus has had it written down, Matthew 24, he said, but the end is not yet.
Right.
This is only the beginning of sorrows. Right. You ain't seen sorrows yet. It is like a woman being in travail, getting ready to have the baby, and there's no C-section. So you're going to have it, whether it is breached, sideways, or any other kind of way, and it's coming out. And it's going to hurt. So no longer will you hear that little voice that's going to urge you to do wrong. Even the animals is going to be at peace. And you wonder, how's that going to be? What is the lion going to eat? What is the bear going to eat? Turn with me to Isaiah 11. I love reading this, so we'll just read this together, okay?
Amen.
Isaiah 11, starting in verse 6. This is what it's going to be like when Jesus returns. And when he returns, you know, like we're going to meet him if we're still alive in the air. And so, not only, Crystal, will you be able to see Jesus coming, you will be a part of that coming. Because if you are, if you have been asleep when he gets ready to return, you're going to rise first. And you're going to meet him in the air as he's returning.
Thank you.
And then those of us that are still alive will join you.
Beautiful.
We all coming down. Yes. Power glory. And great glory. Mm. Big God and little God.
Yes. Little
Jesus. So starting in verse 6, Isaiah 11.
Amen.
It says, in that day The wolf and the lamb will live together. The leopard will lie down with the baby goat. The calf and the yearling will be safe with the lion, and a little child will lead them all. The cow will graze near the bear, and the cub and the calf will lie down together. The lion will eat hay like a cow. No more meat for you. The baby will play safely near the hole of a cobra. Yes, a little child will put his hand in a nest of deadly snakes without harm. Nothing will hurt or destroy in all my holy mountain. For as the waters will fill the sea, so the earth will be filled with people who know the Lord.
Yes.
Amen.
So you're talking about a beautiful time. You don't have to worry about animals, wild animals tearing you to pieces, snakes biting you. Everything will be at peace because Satan will not be here. Everything will be at peace. And so, during that particular time, your job is going to be to teach folks. That's right. You're going to be a spirit being. And remember this, you're going to be just like Christ, as they give a depiction of Christ in the book of Revelation, that his hair was like lamb's wool, and as white as lamb's wool, and his eyes like a flame of fire. And his feet was like brass that has been burnished in a furnace.
Jeez.
And he wore this startling white robe. Could you imagine what heavenly white robe would look like? Mm-hmm. With a golden sash around his waist. And his face will shine like the sun in his full strength. Mm-hmm. And that's what you're going to look like. Mm-hmm. Because as the Bible says in John 3, 1 John 3, that we don't know what we shall look like, but we shall look like him. Just like him when he appears.
Okay.
Your light might not be shining as bright as his, but you're going to be shining. That's right, shining like, you know, like you used to put lotion on to keep you from shining. And like in the day, you put on petroleum jelly and you did shine, almost like the sun in its strength. But that's not the shine we're talking about. That glow of righteousness will be upon you, and a crown upon your head. So, as the people on earth will be trying to gather themselves, it's going to be our job to start getting them together. Because there's going to be a lot of confusion where we go from here. And that's going to be our job. And as it says in Isaiah 30, verse 21, now a lot of folks don't teach this. So you got to know really what you're going to be doing and how it's going to go down like that. And this is going to be exciting what you'll be able to do.
Yeah.
Just like Jesus was when he was resurrected. He was able to go through walls. He was able to appear. Peace be with you. And then he was gone. Mm-hmm. Then he came down, he sat down with him. That's eating drinking wise. Mm-hmm. And then he came, let me teach you something.
Okay.
And they was walking along the way, and all of a sudden somebody else was walking with them.
Jesus.
So in Isaiah 30, verse 20 and 21, this is how it's going to be. It says, and though the Lord gives you the bread of adversity and the water of affliction, yet your teachers will not be moved into a corner anymore. But your eyes shall see your teachers. Mm-hmm. Your ears shall hear a word behind you saying, this is the way, walk in.
Yeah.
Whenever you turn to the right hand or whenever you turn to the left. Mm-hmm. So in other words, folks are going to be around here. Some of them is going to be confused. Some of them may begin to make a mistake, and you're going to be right there. Mm-hmm. You're going to appear to them. Mm-hmm. In whatever likeness or form that is going to be suitable for them in order to get the picture.
Preach.
And you're going to say, no, that's not right. This is the way you go. Walk in, and then you will disappear. You can even do that to some of your folks that has not been converted. Mm-hmm. When the resurrection for them comes around, that you'll be able to appear and disappear. You won't look the same, but you can make yourself, your presence known to them, like Jesus did. Mm-hmm. When they was first looking at Jesus' resurrected body, they didn't know who you were.
Right.
Who is this masked man? Mm-hmm. Until he revealed to them mm-hmm. that he was Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll be able to do that. Isn't that a wonderful thing? You're going to be able to show up to some of your kinfolk that may not have a hard time believing, and they're going to see you. They're going to see you and then not see you. And you can tell them you can make it too. There's a way for you to make it. Because you have made it. But you have been given an opportunity to make it like no other.
Mm-hmm.
You have to make it while Satan is still here, not while he's gone.
Mm-hmm.
So isn't God wonderful? He knows what he's doing.
Amen.
So all the hate and the indifference and the prejudice will no longer dominate the thinking of people now. You know, like it is now, you see in our political scene. Now this, I've never seen this country so divided. I've never seen it so divided. Now back in the 60s it was divided and you had riots and burning down. But the attitude now, the mindset is worse than what it's ever been. And you got an individual that is baiting this for his own purposes. Not to disparage this individual, but just to tell the truth.
Preach.
That's what it is, to tell the truth. Not bringing unity, but bringing division so this individual can gain power. That's how Satan does it. Divide and conquer. So injustice will be a thing of the past. You won't need black lives back. Truly, all lives will matter in the Lord. Then there will be no such thing like you got people going around today, and even us, do you know the Lord? You won't be a need for that because all is going to know the Lord.
Amen.
All is going to have one universal language. We're going to be saying the same thing and knowing the same thing. It's not going to be any differences anymore. It's not going to be any church denominations anymore. This outfit or that outfit. Buddha or Judah or Hoodoo or We Do and all that stuff is going to be gone. All of it is just going to be Christians. Christ-like. That's what you're going to have. And everybody's going to know the same thing.
Amen.
It's not going to be a variation over here and over there. Some godless tradition. Well, this is how we always did. It's no longer going to be judgment on your worship. Some like to jump up and down and roll down the aisles, all right. Some like to sit up stoic and straight and listen to harps and violins play and tell you this is the music I know God listens to. How do they know that? Have they been up there sitting with God while his music is playing? They don't know what's jumping off up there. They never been, and Jesus said that, and no man has been to heaven. Not one, right. Except for me who has come down from heaven. That's mm-hmm. scripture.
Mm-hmm.
So if you said that you have died and gone to heaven, you have been misinformed. You are just dead. Waiting to be resurrected again.
Amen.
Either to everlasting life or everlasting shame and condemnation. So the choice will be ours. But even that choice is going to be laid out for you so you won't be able to miss it. So you can say people then now can worship freely the way you want without all these restrictions and this, that, and the other. Of course, there's going to be, you know, order and respect and everything, but that's going to be no one standing pointing their fingers at this one or that.
Amen.
Or they doing this, or they believe this, or they believe that. All's going to know the truth.
Amen.
All's going to know the same thing.
Amen.
And of course, you're going to have different forms of worship, but none of it is going to be where another person would have to stand up there and criticize it. Because you got folks on the islands going to do it a different way. You know, they got the congas and the bongo drums work. That's right. They're going to be rolling. And then you're going to have something that's going to be like sort of like that. But that's the difference in our personalities. Just like Elijah and Elijah. They were two different individuals. One was fiery, and the other one was very stoic. But they all worship God, and this is going to be the key element. Mm-hmm. We're all going to know God. It's going to be our job to make sure that they know it. Because mm-hmm. you're not going to be sitting around in heaven, floating around on a cloud, playing a harp, eating milk and honey all day. They don't have an unemployment line in heaven.
Right.
Or a couch.
Right.
You'll have potatoes up there, but you won't be one of them. So everybody's going to be, and you're going to be full of energy, mm-hmm. undying energy, energy you will never get tired.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like it is said, in my Father's house there are many mansions, mm-hmm. and people automatically start thinking how they're going to be living. That mansion they never got a chance to get here on earth. Now they gonna have that pad up in heaven. Where they can lay around and lounge and have servants and grass cut and all of that. When you have eternal life and you are a spirit being, what do you need with a house? What do you need with a couch? What, are you gonna sit down and rest? Just think about that. And this is what we think because that's our humanness,
right.
our human nature. You won't need any of that. Mm-hmm. But you will have office of responsibility. Mm-hmm. As I said many times before, what you do now on earth will determine your position in the kingdom.
Mm-hmm.
If you working to serve people and getting ready yourself mm-hmm. from the top of your head to the balls of your feet and become more Christ-like, the bigger the responsibility in the kingdom of God is going to be.
Mm-hmm.
As your mind and your attitude change towards Christ, that's where your elevation will be. And it doesn't matter whether you are the lonely congregant in a congregation
mm-hmm.
or the head pastor.
Mm-hmm.
It does not matter. It is what you have done with what God has given you.
Amen.
And like you said, I'm not a respecter of persons. I'm a man.
Thank you, Lord.
You say, I'm not a man like you that I should lie.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't that condemnation? Mm-hmm. I'm not like you. That I don't lie like you. That's like you.
Thank you. Right.
You might be in my image, but that image is gone a long time ago. So we won't be able, no one will, they'll begin to learn what is right and not what is wrong. Because it won't even be in your psyche.
Mm-hmm.
You know, after 25 years of nothing but goodness is going to be in you.
Okay.
Because it won't be no wrong anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
It won't be no harm anywhere.
Please.
And so we are products of our environment.
Mm-hmm.
And if our environment that way will begin to fill in, because as human beings, we are social creatures.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and those that are hermits will not be hermit anymore because that broadcast won't be in their brains anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And so we need people.
Mm-hmm.
We need each other. Mm-hmm. And so, and we're going to do what everybody else does. Just like you do now. In the world, without God's Holy Spirit, we do like everybody else does in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Right, wrong, indifferent, whatever the world, as we used to have a saying. And you ain't with the world, so you ain't nothing. See, everybody in the world is doing that, man, what's wrong with you?
Mm-hmm.
Now, the deal is, since you know Christ, let the world go.
Preach.
Mm-hmm.
That's why it's going to be hostile against you and the world, because you're not going to do as the world does. You're not going to think as the world does, and it's going to be what's wrong with you. So if you like anything, you're not with me, then you must be against me.
Okay.
Even Jesus says that. You're not with me, you must be against me. If you are with me, then you are with me. And he's going to, as he says in Joel 2, he's going to pour out his spirit on all flesh. Joel 2, verse 29.
Teach.
That means everybody is going to have God's Holy Spirit, so there'll be no excuses. Now, if you don't have God's Holy Spirit, it is no way that you can accept Christ. And it's no way that your name is written in the book of life. You have to have God's Holy Spirit for your name to appear in that book. And only you can erase it. Only you can erase it. Jesus is not going to erase it. You'll have that eraser in your hand. I'm out of here. And you will be out of here. So, what it's going to be for us, whenever, anytime someone does something wrong, or is confused about some aspect, or confused about the word, you know, sometimes the word can be quite challenging to know what that means. Well, what are you really saying here? You know, it got hard sayings. Even Peter said that. He said some of Paul's writing is hard, but I know it's from the Lord.
Amen.
And so we need to, if you don't understand it, just sit tight. It'll come. And as I know many of you have experienced, that you have asked a question, and sooner or later you got that answer.
Amen.
Whether it was the next day, the next week, the next month, the next year, but amen, you got that answer. And that was in God's own time, not yours.
Right, amen.
Because we would love to have, as they used to say, Jesus in a jug. Every time you need it, you just grab that jug, unscrew the top, and pull it out. And then when you didn't need it, you stuffed it back in that jug, closed it up, put it way back in the pantry, and locked the door. I got this. Don't worry about this. I'm handling this. So we will be there to help people. Now, most of you might be thinking, well, I'm going to have all this power if they don't do what I say. Oh, man, are you going to kid? It's not going to be like that.
No.
Did Jesus do that?
No.
He didn't. He encouraged you. He didn't beat you because he knew you didn't know any better. He knew that. He knew that. So we're going to be the same way. We're going to be encouraging them, not beating them. Encourage them to go down. What did the word say? This is the way. Go this way. Do it like this. And people are going to be inclined to hear you because they won't have Satan telling them no.
Right.
Appealing to all of their weaknesses. And we all got them. We all got them. But you won't have an individual that clever with that kind of power to influence you to do something that is direct opposite of God's way. And let me tell you something. It's not following, because it's got a misconception, following God's way is dull and no fun. When you're doing it right and you ain't got all those traditions, you can't do this and you can't do that, you can have a whale of a time in the Lord.
That's right.
You can have more fun than you can shake a stick at.
Because
let me tell you something, the Israelites always look for an excuse to party. They don't say that, but they did.
Yeah.
That's right. That's why it was a big thing to have putting your wine on hand when folks came over.
Amen.
Beer and other, as they say, similar drinks. Break out the fatty calf.
Yeah.
And let's have a party.
Peace.
Weddings last 7 days or more.
That's right.
We get tired after 7 hours. How long is this going? When is this over? I got my feet up. But it won't be that way during the 1,000-year reign of Christ. All that's going to be changed. And look here, the illnesses will start to disappear. All the natural medicines, it'll be natural medicines going to start to take the place of all the pharmaceuticals.
Amen.
You know, Bristol Myers and all Pfizer and the rest of these will be out of business.
That's right.
Won't be no need for aspirin or Motrin 800 or Tramadol, Norco, Vicodin, or Cindacin, or whatever that stuff is. You won't need it. And the Lord tells you that. Ezekiel 47, verse 12. This is how he lays it out. And this is how beautiful it's going to be. Ezekiel 47, verse 12. I'm almost through, y'all. He says, it reads, along the bank of the river, on this side and that, will grow all kinds of trees used for food.
Amen.
And the leaves will not wither, and their fruit will not fail. They will bear fruit every month, because there is water flow from the sanctuary. And their fruit will be for food, and their leaves for medicine.
Amen.
Isn't that something? Leaves for medicine, all kind of aches and pains, scrapes and scratches that you got to leave with a leaf on, or chew a leaf, or boil a leaf, and it's over. You don't have to worry about that anymore. Plus, folks are going to be healthy anyway. Mm-hmm. I doubt there'll be a McDonald's and a Burger King. And trust me, I know what goes into a Burger King burger. I used to work in a plant that supplied them their meat. I have not eaten another Burger King burger ever since, and that's a fact. So you won't have that kind of trash in your food. Because good food, and let me tell you something, when it's good and healthy, you don't need to eat a whole lot of it.
Right, right.
You don't. Because it's there, it sustains you. Mm-hmm. Even the bread back in the day was enough to keep you alive. Mm-hmm. The bread, because it had such nutrients mm-hmm. in it.
Preach.
And so this is the Lord really fulfilling his promise, as he says in 2 Peter 3, verse 9. And this is what I love about it, when you begin to really know the Lord, when you begin to really know what's up his sleeve, what the prophecy is really all about. Second Peter 3 and verse 9, it said, and a lot of people think this, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering towards us, not willing that any should perish, but all should come to repentance.
Preach.
Here's the deal, and this is a time that's going to be a very critical time. This is what a lot of people don't understand. When the Lord says that, now he's not a respecter of persons, nor even he is a man that he should lie. So all will have to go through Christ to get to God and to get to the kingdom. So when Christ came, I don't know how many billions of people were here and gone. They never knew Christ. They didn't get an opportunity to go through Christ.
Right.
They didn't know.
Right.
And if you're clever enough, as you read in the gospel, he talks about these old time places that got destroyed. Sodom and Gomorrah, Sodom and Tyre. Very wicked places in ancient times. And now they were all gone. They're destroyed. But what does he say? He say in judgment time, it's going to be easier for them than for you, Capernaum.
Yeah,
in which all the miracles, the things I did and you saw, and you didn't believe, you still acting a fool. Mm-hmm. So in the day of judgment, now wait a minute, they're all gone. So there's going to be a time of judgment, like right now is judgment. Judgment is on the house of the Lord.
Teach.
So what is judgment? Judgment is what you do right now. You have a life to live in the knowledge of Christ. So these individuals are going to have a life to live, and they're going to be able to know Christ. Mm-hmm. And he said they're going to be even Capernaum. Now, all those folks are dead and gone too. But Christ was there. Mm-hmm. So even these places that Christ wasn't, as wicked as Sodom and Gomorrah was, okay, will have a better time in the kingdom than they will. Mm-hmm. Because much is forgiven, then that individual, if you got a lot of excess baggage on you and that's been removed, you got a lot of sins on you and that's been removed, a lot of bad stuff, and it's been wiped away, you're going to be more on fire for the Lord than the man that thinks he only got a couple of things to get rid of.
Teach.
Right.
Teach.
And so what's going to happen during this 1,000 years, and when the 1,000 years are up, all those that didn't know Christ is going to be raised up on their feet so they can meet their Savior.
Yeah.
Like he says, not to any shall perish. All will have an opportunity.
Right.
So if you have not been called, and some people think they've been called and have not, and you can tell, and God said you can tell them by their fruit. He said a lot of them are going to be coming up and saying, Lord, Lord, Lord. And he say, who are you? I don't know you. But we cast out demons in your name. We did this, we did that. He said, away, away, away. I don't know you. So in other words, you got to take what he's going to give you when your mind is open, and now you got to apply it to your life and start to change. And everyone is going to have an opportunity, everyone that ever lived. And they're going to, most of them, I believe, do believe, and he gives reference that out of all the people in the world that has ever lived, only about 10% ain't going to make it. Well, that 10% going to be in the billions. Because if you take a look at it, and if they did the mathematics, when the new heaven and earth came down, and with the dimensions that it had, it can hold somewhere in the neighborhood of 60 billion.
Jeez.
Remember, there's tens upon tens of thousands of angels. And so there's millions of angels. Remember, there's an angel there for each one of us.
Mm-hmm.
And there's millions of us. So, you know, we can't put God in a box.
Right.
After all, we got a universe out here, and he's beyond it.
Jeez.
And so you take a look at that, because in the end, you know, when Satan is released, now you don't get no free ride.
Mm-hmm.
And you can say this, when you're raised up, at least you'll get a free chance to know God without Satan ever being around.
Mm-hmm.
So the only thing you're going to ever know is goodness and righteousness and doing what is right. You're going to know all that stuff you did in the past was always backwards.
Mm-hmm.
It's wrong. And so, but there is a proven time, because he's not going to allow you to get to the kingdom and you are still corrupt. So after all this teaching and what the Bible says, that in Isaiah 65 verse 20 gives you a hint, when these folks raise up, they got a time, but plenty of time to repent and get it together. They said, Isaiah 65, verse 20, no more shall an infant from there live but a few days, nor an old man who has not fulfilled his days when he's resurrected. For the child shall die 100 years old, but the sinner, being 100 years old, shall be accursed. So these folks are going to have 100 years to get it together. Isn't that beautiful?
Yes.
100 years. So if you died full of hell and you was 90 years old, you'll be 109 before your time of testing comes. And everybody gets a time of testing. Because he's not going to give you eternal life and power to live forever, and you can be corrupted forever. So there's a test. You're going to be tested. It's like we go through trials and tribulations. Now those are tests to see whether or not you're going to stick and stay. To see whether or not you're going to obey me, even in adverse conditions. That's why your particular responsibility and your position, you're always going to be with Christ. Wherever he goes, you're going to be with him. And no other generation is going to be that. Those that comes up afterwards, those that's going to survive after the great tribulation and after the wrath of God, will not be in that position, because you would have made it while Satan is still out here.
Right.
You have proven yourself. Proven yourself. Not to say you were state free, because you're not. But you have did enough. And through his grace, then you'll be given that position of responsibility forever.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody can take it from you. Forever. And that's where you'll be with the Lord. As Daniel said, some will be shining bright. Some will be bright, but they won't be so bright. Some might even be dull. But he said, even if you're a little dull, it's better to be a little dull in the kingdom than to be the best man on earth. And I believe it. I believe it. And so they got 100 years, so you got an insight of what's going to happen here. So everybody ain't lost. You ask the person, well, what happens to all these people that was dead before Christ came? What happened to them? Oh, well, they God just won't judge them so hard. Wrong. Nobody gets a free ride. He's not a respecter of persons. He's fair. He's not us.
Preach.
Everybody's going to go through it. Now, they might not, they're not going to go through it to the degree we're going to go through it and we're going through it. Because they're going to have all this time, and some of them is going to be around here 1,000 years. That's hard to, for a human being to believe. Couldn't live. I mean, they've already 80. What do you mean live 1,000 years? Why not? A lot of folks back in the day almost lived 1,000 years. You gonna put a limit on God? You see what he can't do? If he can raise you up from the dead, you've been dead for 6,000 years.
Yeah.
I think he can keep you alive. Of course, all of this is going to be in preparation. Now, these folks ain't gonna be just hanging around like they flying around on clouds doing nothing. They're gonna be getting logistics together. Because when you bring up all these billions of people, they're going to have housing, clothing, food. They're going to have jobs. They're going to have all of that.
Preach.
And so, but you don't imagine, you can't imagine what it'd be like to build things like that when everybody is in one accord. A few people get together with their minds, the same purpose can do tremendous things. And when you're going to have a billions of them in that mode, well, they can get a lot of things prepared and ready, which is going to happen, and hallelujah, because we're going to have more brothers and sisters. But don't be thinking that, just don't get all uppity, because you're going to be the first fruits and be with Jesus, because there you go again, human nature. Think about your power and your position. You're going to be over there. But you're not going to have that mindset.
Right.
I know you're not going to have that mindset. Because you got that mindset, you don't have to worry about your mind anymore. So what a wonderful job we're going to have that God is going to give us. Much like the one we got right now. That's right. To teach and encourage people. But this time on a scale that you cannot even imagine, with the power you cannot even imagine. But it's going to be a beautiful thing. So try to imagine that sometimes when you're meditating. Think on those things, that what's going to happen. And sometimes when you're going through a bad spot in your life, it'll be good to think about something that's what you're looking for in the future. And then it won't seem so bad.
Amen.
Now, I know when you go through trials, they are meant to hurt you. God says they're meant to hurt you. Because it wouldn't be a trial if it didn't hurt you. And he said, I'm going to chasten every son that I love. But if I do not, if you're not going in any trials, I think you better go in your prayer closet and start fasting and praying to get you one.
Okay.
Because he said, if you are not none of mine, then you won't have no trial. You're going to go through life blissfully. Da-di-da-di-da. Nothing can bother me. Then you got troubles. You got troubles. But unfortunately, everybody here I know does not have those kind of troubles. You got troubles, but you don't have that kind of
thing.
So our job is going to be helping people in their salvation. Not that you're going to give it, but you're going to help them in theirs as they walk with God. Because they're going to need to be taught, and that's going to be our job. So it is so important that we learn now all that we can. All that we can, because it is our preparation for the kingdom of God. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.